haven't worshipped in 2 weeks. Oh, wait.
I just get what you're trying to do there.
Yeah, I thought that's what you guys were trying to do. I didn't pick up on the humor. Alright, so, let's pray. Dear Father, we just want to thank you for being here with us tonight, as you are everywhere. But especially right here with us, as we worship you and learn about you and fellowship in your name. I want to thank you especially for your son. We just finished learning about him in Mark recently. But never want to forget. And on that note, silence your cell phones. I heard someone go, I'm not going to point fingers because I don't know who it is.
But if
I did, I would point fingers.
Just put it everywhere.
Someone over there. I thought it was you, that's what.
You just point fingers sure verbally.
Oh, it's definitely not me.
Was you?
That happens to pastors every once in a while.
The porn stocks are up the roof.
That's really a serious one.
Turn your phones up!
Oh, yeah. I'm back now. Alright,
put
those
shit on the roof.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Giving us that freedom, that wings like eagles, and that we can place our hope in you, Lord. I pray tonight as we really kind of dig down into a little bit of hope, that you would really minister to our lives wherever we're at. If we're having a good time, if we're in a downtime, if we're in those in-between times, wherever we are, we're supposed to be hoping in you. I pray that we would see that come to life in a new way tonight. Even though we study something that's been taught thousands of times over and over again, Lord, your word is still living and powerful and can come to life. So I pray that we have open hearts, that you would do an awesome, awesome thing inside this little room. And I pray that you would bring healing tonight and comfort and welcoming. Lord, honor us with your presence. That would be so amazing to have a surplus of your time. We love you, Father, in Jesus' name. All right, guys. So, I'm going to limp over to this seat because yesterday, this is what happens when Taylor Wren comes and starts living with you again. You start jumping over the couch. And then as you're watching this bear jump over the couch, you're going, I can do that too. And then you go and do it, and you pull a tendon. So I'm not much of a man, and I'm in excruciating pain right now in my leg. So lesson learned from this, don't jump over your house with Taylor Wren. Jump over your couch. Yeah. Don't jump over your house either. Probably won't.
You know what it is? Your mom knew. She just telegraphed that pain.
Yeah. All right, guys. So, God has still not shown me a book to read yet. Like one that we can stick in, and I don't know why. But we are going to be reading in Psalms 130 tonight. We're going to be kind of popping around in Psalms today.
Have you picked a bigger chapter, David?
I wanted to make sure it was readable for Stephen. He knows that Stephen's attention span is far.
So,
hey!
Yes. Forget
about it in a second.
Did you want to? Oh, how
cute.
Krista has a serious face on
her. Psalm 130.
Okay. All right, guys.
Chapter in Psalms.
Yeah. I want you to ask yourself this question, guys. I want you to ask yourself, where am I at with the Lord? Am I in one of those times where I am floating on clouds in the high places? Am I kind of hoping I'm going to get to those clouds soon and feeling like I can't make it very much? Are you coming down off of the clouds and realizing you're falling a lot quicker than you were climbing? Or are you down inside the valley fighting? Now, I use this figuratively of our walk with Christ. Now, you're either ascending to the mountaintop experience, and you're like, oh, I'm going to die. Just like we were feeling in Zion a couple times, climbing up those trails. Well, not Taylor, but. Are we inside the clouds going, wow, God, this is such an awesome experience with you? Or are we coming down the mountain at a steady pace, or possibly just, no! outside the valley, which is where most Christians are most of the time, which is normal day-to-day life, where there's constantly fighting battles, and there seems to be very, very little to no relief. Any side of that you're on, there has to be something you hold on to, and that's hope. Hope that you're going to get up to that relief. Hope that God has so much better in store for you up in that mountaintop experience. And let me get you down the mountain. Hope that you're not going to die as you're falling down the mountain or descending it. And hope that he will get you through the battle down in the valley. Now that was something before I left, guys, you remember how I was talking a lot about forgiveness and brokenness? Well, I got my mountaintop experience, and that was this last week, when I went on vacation. I was able to go and worship the Lord with 1,300 other pastors and men of God. I was able to constantly be fed awesome teachings and hear much wiser men than me get up and talk about their experiences with the Lord. And it was awesome. And I was like, floating and stuff. And then right after that, we got to go to Zion. We got to see God's nature and his beauty. And we got a fellowship up there. And I watched as our group, those who went, were just coming unglued and sharing some of the stuff that's your deepest, darkest secrets. And then I was like, just completely flying. and then we came back to Vegas. And I was like, and I just smashed into the ground and started rolling, and I made a big mistake when I was up in the mountains. I asked God, try me. and know me. But you know what? Yes, I hit hard. But as I watched my bones breaking again so quickly after being met in so little time, you know what? God has something big in store. And I can't fail to remember to hope on him. I just left and saw what he could do. I got up to the mountaintop. I saw how he could get me there. And now I'm going to, as I'm rolling down this mountain, I'm going to roll into the valley, and I'm going to have to stand up and start fighting right away. I'm going to hope that he's going to be right in front of me, showing me how to fight as he's slaying the people for me. That's what we get to read a little about today in Psalm 130. The context of this scripture is this man talking about being forgiven, and then him going into hope, hoping on the Lord that he will forgive him. But application-wise, guys, I think there's a lot more application to this. We can also hope in the Lord for everything. He is not just the God of forgiveness, but much more, because he's awesome. So let's read this, and we'll jump over it. Out of the depths I have cried to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits. It's a good song. And in his word I do hope. My soul waits for the Lord. More than those who watch for the morning. Yes, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is mercy, and with him is abundant redemption. And he shall redeem Israel from all his iniquities. All right. Out of the depths. You might be sitting here going, well, David, that's nice that you're having your, like, fluffy, cloud-like feelings, going and worshiping with 1,300 pastors. Wow, that's great for you. But right now, I'm kind of in a hole. But guess what? That's where the psalmist was, too. And before I was on the mountaintop, that's where I was as well. We went to a place called Camp U-Turn while we were down in California. And this is a camp where people get together, and for punishment, they take holes. Holes that are 5 feet by 5 feet. So 5 feet deep, 5 feet wide, all the way down. And then they get to bury, you know, after they're done digging it, they get to put all the dirt back in, and then they get their food. And these guys, what they say is, as they're digging down, the first foot, they're angry. They're super mad. The second foot, they're like, okay, what did I do? The third foot, they're like, I'm going to die. The fourth foot, they're like, I'm almost done. The fifth foot, they're like, I'm digging myself to hell. That's what they said. And once they get down that fifth foot and they're like, I'm digging myself to hell, what do they do? Where do they have to look to? They have to look up. Out of the depths. So you're in the depths looking out of it. Picture yourself inside one of those 5-foot holes. You're looking out and you're crying unto the Lord, hear me, dear Jesus. I'm almost to hell. Hear me. Let your ears be attentive. This word attentive means giving me your full attention. Paying attention to me. Don't think when you pray, you can't pray about yourself. If you stop praying that God equips you and God helps you, you're in big trouble because you're not being equipped properly. So here you have this guy. He's crying out of the depths that the Lord would hear him. Hear his pleas. That's what supplications means. Something that I want you to do for me. If you, Lord, should mark iniquities, oh Lord, who could stand? Mark. You know what, guys? We miss the mark all the time. Often and often. So how interesting you use this word. If you mark our iniquities, marks means like preserve. Not forget, to keep watch of. If you keep watch of my sins, who can stand? You know, God is the only person who can truly forgive and forget. He's the only person that can truly do that. We're called to forgive. Return, you know, that saying, forgive and forget, that's nowhere inside the Bible. We're called to forgive. Not necessarily forget, but we're not supposed to bring up sin. We're not supposed to bring up sin to hurt somebody else. But we are supposed to be watchful. But the Lord, you see, if he were to preserve our sin, we would be in messed up shape. But he doesn't. Why does he not keep sin? Because he forgives. And forgiveness is being redeemed from judgment. It's an act and characteristic that only God has truly demonstrated. I know that I've forgiven and I haven't truly forgiven before. Only God can truly forgive. That's what he does. He truly forgives. And when he forgives us, when we're crying out to him from our holes, he forgives us because it glorifies himself. And you might think, what does that mean? This is crazy. Look, by a perfect man saving us imperfect people, makes him all the more perfect and righteous. It's easy to help someone you love, but Christ is constantly helping someone that hates him or shows characteristics opposite of love. We are his people and we show characteristics opposite of love to him all the time. That word, that you may be feared, also could be read this way. You are awesome. That word feared is the same word they use for awesome too, which I think is awesome. Because
I think that's feared.
We can look at God and be like, this man has the power to completely, hold condemnation over my head. But he squishes that condemnation and throws it as far as the east is from the west. And let me tell you, I don't know how long it is, but I don't think anybody will have to figure that out. But he can do it, because he's God and he's awesome. And so as we're being forgiven, we're like, whoa! Yeah! You know? He's just so cool. And so awesome and so righteous. And this is what leads us to hope. This word wait in verse 5. If you think about it, we hear the word wait all the time. Wait, 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 wait. Christian needs wait, 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 wait. And we're sitting there. And I don't think we actually understand what the word actually means. This word here, does anybody have a guess what it might mean?
Go. Wait. Wait.
Yes. Does anybody else have a guess what it might mean? Not you.
Wait.
Yes.
Actively wait.
Actively wait. Mm-hmm.
Wait. Expectation
or something to happen.
Ooh.
I was gonna say paragraph.
Now that's interesting. Expectation of something to happen. That kind of goes. It's Ellie, right? That kind of goes with what Ellie is saying. Actively waiting, with expectation, eagerly. You're sitting there and you're like, well, I thought waiting was just kind of like.
Huh. Like you do for your wine.
Delete that.
There's a difference between waiting for and waiting on.
Oh, boy.
Are these the merriments?
I think everybody says, it says, I wait for the Lord, I expectantly wait, and in his word I do hope. God is the only one that can give us hope. God is the only one that can give us that patience, and we expectantly wait for him to move. We expectantly wait for him to speak.
Yes. We have to, well, not have to. Waiting is something that you can be eager about, excited for, expectant of. And that's what hope truly means to you. Believing in something that will come to pass. What are you hoping for the Lord? Are you in that muck and mire? Are you 5 feet deep going, save me? Watch and see how he will save you. It might not be the coziest thing, but he will get you out of there. What are those things that are your desires? Those things that you want, that you know go parallel to his will. When it says, my soul waits, I want you guys to key in there. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits. That word soul also means, and this is what's good about the Psalms, is because the Psalms are tricky, because it's Hebrew. And Hebrew words mean everything. My passions. My desires. I wait for the Lord. My passions wait. My desires wait. For what? His word. And this word is actually not the word logos. I forgot to write it down because I'm a dork. But this word means his, what is it? I don't want to mess this up. Acts, his advice, and his affairs. So, we are to be eagerly expecting, waiting, actively. But our desires and our passions must be parallel to the will of God. His acts, his affairs, his advice. Does everybody understand where I'm going? That is key to true hope. And, you know, if we could just get that, I think our rides would be a lot less bumpy as we're sitting there, because I don't know about you guys, I really don't like when the road gets bumpy because you're sitting there like, and you're like, oh, when is this going to end?
I was going to go,
But if you just go, you're having a lot more fun because you're like, this world's going to end eventually. You know, it's very true. Thank you, Tyler. the illustration he used here, more than those who watch for the morning, those are like the people you see who were on the walls inside ancient times, so not that you see, that you hear about, that are on the walls looking out, waiting for the sun to rise so their shift is over. Those are, it's an illustration of people inside hospitals who are watching the sick during the night. And I think that there is something a little truly more scary about watching somebody during the night in a hospital than there is during the daytime. They want the sun to come up. A traveler on the road as they're marching on throughout the night. This is also an illustration of them too. As they're sitting there and they're going, good heavens, it would be nice to know where I'm going. The moon's gone, the sun's not up, I don't even know where I'm going. Hopefully this is still the path. We are supposed to wait more expectantly than even these guys who are done. That is what I fail to do sometimes. Sometimes I'm like, oh yeah, Jesus! Other times I'm like, yeah, hope in the Lord. You're taking a long time. This probably isn't going to happen. Let's move on. And that's not true. I need to believe that my God is big and powerful. And sometimes I fail to do that. We're watching for the morning eagerly. We're watching for the sun to rise. Think about that from a spiritual context. You know that feeling when it's winter and the sun starts coming up and you feel your skin start defrosting a little bit as it brings some sort of heat and it actually becomes a comfort rather than a hindrance like it does in the city? That's a great feeling. That's what he's going to do to our hearts as we wait expectantly for him. He's going to start defrosting us, warming us up, getting us going. Oh, Israel, hope in the Lord. I always kind of read this in my mind, hope for the Lord, but that is incorrect. Hope for the Lord is completely different than hoping in the Lord. Tyler, explain to me how.
I would say hoping in the Lord, you're like, everything would be one with him. So you're already like one with him. So you're hoping in him because you know him.
That's it. You're in the Lord. You're in his presence. You're not waiting for him to come. You're waiting with him there. That is active waiting. Waiting expectantly. You too. We know you're going to see that too. Yes, exactly. In the Lord. Oh, Israel. Now, I've often heard, correct me if I'm wrong, Pastor Jim, Israel's often referred to as a her, correct?
Yes.
But down here in verse 8, it says, and he shall redeem Israel from all his iniquities. So that makes me think. Something a little more personal. Jacob. This was Israel. He was a man who wrestled with the Lord, who sinned, but even after sinning, he asked the Lord to bless me. And if you want to look up the reference for that, guys, it's in Genesis 32:27-29, where God names Jacob Israel. Jacob was his chosen boy, and he was given a new name. And guys,
reminds me of something that was given to us, a new life. Once Jacob became Israel, he started acting differently. He was still the same Jacob. But he started walking a little more near to God, because at the point, Jacob was kind of having a hard time. Jacob started walking nearer to God as he had a new name. And we have been given a new name. We've been given the name of Christ in our hearts. So you can almost read this, oh Stephen, oh Tyler, oh Lauren, oh Jacob, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is mercy. I like how NASB again puts this. Please do not tell my mom I keep referring to NASB. But it says, for with the Lord there is loving kindness. I think that puts it a little more. Undeserved love. That's why we can hope in Him with everything. As long as our hopes parallel with His will and our contrary course, we can hope in Him for all things. And He shall redeem you, me, from all our iniquities. Let's flip over to Psalm 37, just to get some backup scripture.
137 or Psalm 37?
Psalm 37. Verse 3. It says, trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell on the land and feed on His faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and He shall give you your desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in Him, and He shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth your righteousness as the light, and your justice as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because the man who burns wicked schemes to pass. Because of the man who brings wicked schemes to pass. Guys. Hope. He will bring it to pass. Read that verse. Remember it. It's very powerful and very moving. Very encouraging in such dark times. Hope in the Lord. Rise. Get out of that 5 feet ditch. You're not there forever. And you're going, how am I going to get out, David? Jesus. And that guy will bring ladders out of heaven with angels crawling up and down like crazy if he has to. He can also make a flood happen. Who knows how he will get you out of that ditch. But I know he will. Just hope in it. Don't not be expecting him to move. And as you're doing that, you might just go, okay. Try me, O Lord, and search my heart. Know my anxieties and see if there is any wicked way in me. And lead me in the way everlasting. As we hope in Him, as we trust in Him, as He forgives us of our sins, He will lead us to the way everlasting. As we let Him in and wait in Him inside our life and our trust. Amen.
Can I share a scripture real quick?
Yes.
Isaiah 30:18. The Lord showed me this yesterday.
Wait.
As I was praying or something. Isaiah 30:18.
Proceed. I'm ready.
I do not have any escape. Therefore, the Lord longs to be gracious to you. And therefore He waits on high to have compassion on you. For the Lord is a God of justice. How blessed are those who, mine says long for Him, but I looked at another version and it says, who wait for Him.
Amen.
That's what mine said.
That's what mine said too.
You got the non-inspired version.
Are you guys reading the same book?
No.
True. Who knew? Who knew? Guys, let's pray. Lord, as we hope in you, please be faithful to us. Dear God, guide us along our way. And let us wait in you each and every step of the way. You, Lord, are awesome and someone to be feared. In your powerful and awesome and holy name, your saints pray. Amen. So, Pastor Jim,
bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing your song again, whatever may pass and whatever lies before. held high. Such small sacrifice. If not joined with my life, I sing in vain tonight. May the words I say and the things I do make my life something, bring a smile to you.
Thank you. I try to hold on to this world with everything I have, but I feel the weight of what it brings and the hurt that tries to grab. Many trials that seem to never end. His word declares this truth. We will enter in this rest with wonders anew. But I hold on to this hope and the promise that he brings. There will be a place with no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. But until that day, we'll hold on to you always. The journey seems so long. You feel you're walking on your own, but there has never been a step where you've walked out all alone. Troubled soul, don't lose your heart. The joy and peace he brings in the beauty that's in store outweighs the hurt of life's sting. But I hold on to this hope and the promise that he brings. There will be a place with no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face.
God bless you guys.
Your blood speaks a better word.
than all the empty claims I've heard upon this earth. Speaks righteousness for me and stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood. Your blood speaks a better word than all the empty claims I've heard upon this soul. Speaks righteousness for me and stands in my defense. Jesus, it's your blood.
troubles come and my heart burdened be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
Not proud, love does not boast. Love, after all, matters the most. Love does not run, love does not hide, love does not keep locked inside. Love is a river that flows through, and love never fails you. Love will sustain, love will provide, love will not cease at the end of time. And love will protect. Love always hopes. And love still believes when you don't. Love is the arms that are holding you. Love never fails you. My heart won't make a sound when I can't turn back around. When the sky is falling down, nothing is greater than this, greater than this. 'Cause love is right here. Love is alive. Love is the way, the truth, the life. Love is the river that flows through. Love is the arms that are holding you. And love is a place you will fly to. Love never fails you.
Climb a mountain.